Sounds good, right? This is a kalimba I've made, and for those who don't know what a kalimba is, it's a musical instrument that has got its origins from Africa. It has got a lot of other names, some of which I cannot pronounce. It is commonly called as a thumb piano, obviously because we hold it in our palm and we use our thumb to pluck the strings. There are lots of videos here on YouTube on this same very topic. The making methods, the form factors, sound quality, the music scale, they'll all be different in each of these videos, but the functionality is almost the same. I've made kalimba twice before here on my channel. No, you don't have to go and watch those videos because the method I'm about to show you is much simpler. Any beginner can try it out. You could be really proud of something that you've made, especially when that works. I'm Josh and you're welcome to my channel, Video Epo. I do really mean it when I say any beginner can make it. I'm using power tools here, but it can be made using hand tools as well. All it is a wooden box with some spring steel attached on top of it. So let me take you through the process that ends up like this. I've been working with these wooden edge band runners and I have lots of them. When they are glued together, they can be made into thin sheets of wood, which otherwise would need a lot of hard work. In my first attempt, the hollow resonance chamber was a coconut shell. I made the tines myself by cutting spring steel. I found an alternative, which was the spring steel used in the wiper blades, and I replaced them later. It sounded a lot better. Then on my second attempt, I made a box out of wood and used the tines made out of the wiper blades, and it turned out to be even better. Now all that fuss is over, as the tines are available ready-made and they are really inexpensive. I got these tines for 100 rupees. Let us look at the pack and see what we've got.
So these are the things that are in this pack, and I do not know the names of all of these things. This is, I think it's called the bridge, where it holds all the tines. There are 5 screws given already, which go into these 5 screw holes. There is a metal rod, which kind of creates tensions. And there are 16 notes or 16 tines. The cool thing is, I don't know if it is possible to show it to you on the camera. Let's have a closer look. It has a number as well as the note that it is supposed to play when it is on the kalimba. So that's really cool. The maximum distance my hands or my thumb can cover without a much fuss or changing my hand position would be around 6.5 inches. So I'm going to make the width of the kalimba to be about 6 inches, and the length of it can be somewhere around 8 or 9. I'll figure that out later.
We also need a dowel, which is nothing but a broken mop stick in this case. Sorry about this horrible angle, but all I'm doing here is making repeated cuts of 7.5 inches in length. Then I cut a square piece of straight runner of 1/2 inch by 1/2 inch. Splitting the dowel into 2 equal halves is a bit tricky, as it might roll over, causing an accident. Attaching a fat piece of wood to the bottom might do the trick, and it worked.
We have a bunch of wooden runners that are about 7.5 inches, and some are about 6 inches. I've also cut a dowel into half, and there is a wood piece that matches the size of this dowel. There is going to be a groove that is going to be cut into this particular wooden piece, and this is not cut to length. And again, there is another wood piece, and the size is kind of approximated. This will be underneath the main or the top piece, and this particular part will be held onto the wood. Now let's get to glue.
While gluing all of these, I realized why clamps are so important and why there are so many videos on how to make clamps. Maybe I should try making a few in my coming times. This is a part where we can take a break and let the pieces dry overnight. Getting back to work the next day, all of the pieces have to be cut to the right size. Having at least one side of the pieces straight makes the work a lot easier. Once all pieces were cut and squared, the final size was fine-tuned to 2 inches for the sides. The side pieces were also cut to a bevel angle of 45 degrees. You could go with a simple butt joint if you choose to keep it simple, or if you don't have the necessary tools. All it is a wooden box. A little sanding was needed to remove all the paper that was stuck on it while gluing. Next, the sides of the box were glued together. These were clamped and let to dry for some time. Make sure it is square from all the corners to avoid hassle later. Using this open box as a reference, the top and bottom pieces are cut to the right size. From here on, what follows is easy, but it is very important. The place for the dowel is marked and it is cut to the length matching the tine holder we found in the package. I figured out it is called a Z bracket, but let's call it a tine holder cause it's easy to understand. The wood piece that goes underneath the top plate which holds the tine holder is cut to length as well. The wood piece on which the metal rod sits needs to have a groove. This can be made using wood carving rotary drill bits. I made it slightly longer as it was easy for me to work with and then cut it to size. Although this can be done using a file, Dremel works faster. The iron rod is placed in the groove and a drop of super glue is good enough to keep it in place. So these are four pieces that get fixed on the top plate. These three pieces here are set on top in the order that you see. Placement of the distance between them depends on the length of the tines one might have. Before fixing everything, the top part was sanded for a smooth finish. Time to finish this box up and we glue the bottom cover first. While it's drying, the top part can be assembled. The dowel is glued first, then leaving space for the tine holder, the tension rod is glued as well. Next, the tine holder is placed and the drill holes were marked. After drilling these holes, the top cover is flipped and the supporting wood piece is glued to the bottom. Once it was dry, the tine holder is attached using screws. We can now permanently cover the box with the top cover and glue it in its place.
While the parts were drying, I took the time to arrange all the tines in order so that work becomes a lot easier when I start inserting the tines.
Once again, before attaching the tines, all of the sides and edges were sanded smooth to touch as it was the finish that I was going after. There needs to be a hole in the center on the top piece of the box for the sound to resonate, and hence I made this sound hole too. Finally, coating it with oil brings the wood texture to life. This is always my go-to finish. The tines could be very stubborn to set in, but a set of nose pliers can make them comply. So here are the mistakes that most of us can make. This dowel doesn't seem to serve the purpose properly and the distance between the holder and the iron rod is too much. There are some tines that are really small and might not resonate properly if their length is not pried enough. The way I fixed it is using another 10mm rod adjacent to the tine holder. Even a large nail could be used.
It is not tuned and I need to work on that. Guys, please do let me know what you think about this Kalimba I've made. If you like this video, please do share it with your friends. It means a lot to me when you guys subscribe to my channel. I'll be back with another video very soon. Until then, bye.